The following feature presentation is part of the Skywalking Network.
Hey, Bryn.
Yes?
Totally tell me everything.
About what?
About Tinkerbell. Welcome, everyone, to Totally Tell Me Everything. Today, we're going to be talking about fairies, specifically Tinkerbell. And I'd like to welcome my friend Bryn on to the podcast. Hello, Bryn McKinnon.
Hello, Sarah Woloski. Thank you for having me again.
You're welcome. I don't think I could really do this without you.
That's true. It's sort of both of our shows. I don't know why I said having me on again. That was weird.
That's okay. You know what? You come on Skywalking, so, you know, I don't know.
I'm used to being a guest. I guess I'm used to being a guest.
Right. But this is like your show too. So why don't you explain how this show works?
I would love to. Every month, we choose a topic that we are interested in and that we sort of want to learn more about. And we ask each other three different questions. The questions change depending on what the topic is, but it's usually a question we have for each other about the topic, then something we want to deep dive about that topic, and then one thing we're excited about the topic.
Exactly.
I like to say topic many, many ways.
Topic. I know, topic.
Topic.
It's such a literary, no, like a school word, right?
It is. Yeah. Yeah.
Topic.
Topic. What's the topic? Or like a television show where it's like a debate show or something. Tonight's topic.
Right. So last month we talked about tea, and this month that just kind of dovetailed into fairies somehow. Actually, Bryn, you were the one who thought up this topic of Tinkerbell / fairies. So can you explain like what was going through your head?
I don't remember why I wanted to do this, but because you have a sort of personal interest in Tinkerbell, and you have over the years, and I have kids, and we watched a lot of the Tinkerbell movies in the 2000s. I forget how far they went into the 2010s. I just love Tinkerbell and fairies in general. And I decided, or I imagine that we had a lot we could talk about with respect to fairies and Tinkerbell. So I don't know, just threw it out there and it stuck.
It did. And I think you're right, because our main question one is like really long.
There's a lot to talk about.
Yeah. So this is the question we came up with, and we figured that everyone would be interested in this. What are the different versions of Tinkerbell specifically, and how have they affected us, if at all? Because there's many different versions that we know about, and I'm sure there's more that we haven't touched on here, but we'll get to them. So what we're going to do is we're going to start back in 1911 to talk about the original Tinkerbell from the Peter Pan novel, and we're going to move all the way up through the years to, let's see, oh, like the Tinkerbell films that you were just talking about, right?
Yes.
All right, so let's go back to the original Tink from the Peter Pan novel, 1911. And Bryn, I think you should start this because you were the one who told me to read this. So go ahead.
Yes, yeah. So when my daughter, who's 15, was very little, my grandmother gave her a little trio of kind of classic hardback children's novels. And so I read to my kids a lot. And so we started reading, and one of them was Peter Pan, the original Peter Pan by J.M. Barrie, which was published in 1911, like you said. So I'd never read it as a kid. I only knew the Disney Peter Pan. And I absolutely fell in love with this book. It's so different from the Disney film, and it's so complicated and rich and kind of heartbreaking in many ways. Mm-hmm. And I just love it. So, and Tinkerbell is a very specific sort of character in this book. She's sort of awful, but also like you sort of can admire her because she's just so determined. The thing that I think is so funny and interesting about this book, and I think this word meant something different when this novel was written than it does now, but one of the main things I remembered from the book about Tinkerbell is that she calls Peter a silly ass at least 3 times.
Yes, you silly ass. Even when she's like dying or something, or almost dying at one point. Like, I was like, what's going on? So I'm not sure what that meant back then. I don't know.
I think it means fool, like a donkey.
Oh, okay.
Like stubborn, obstinate, stupid.
Yes, that would
foolish.
Make more sense.
Yeah.
Rather than like a slur or something.
Right, right, right. I don't think it meant but.
Right.
But so one of the conflicts I think that Tinkerbell has with Peter and the whole everybody else who's around is that it seems in the book that Tink is in love with Peter. But Wendy also is in love with Peter. It seems like maybe in the book, Tiger Lily's also in love with Peter because Peter says he's looking for a mother, but that Tiger Lily and Tink didn't seem to want to be his mother. They wanted something else, but he didn't know what it was.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah, and Wendy seemed maybe the same. So he doesn't get it because he's a kid, right? He's a boy, a young boy who is not paying attention to things. But anyway, I think that's partly why she calls him a silly ass, because she's like, I'm right here trying to love you, and you keep talking to other girls and shoving me away and treating me
right.
Like,
right. Whatever. She's very jealous, and that jealousy does
she's
come
very
out.
Jealous. Yes. Yeah. Yes. And so something else I like about, or I think that distinguishes this Tinkerbell from the subsequent Tinkerbells we're going to talk about, is that she is referred to as being insolent and not very polite and quite a common fairy. Ooh. So no one really says nice stuff about Tinkerbell in this book.
No, she's certainly not a beloved icon.
No. Also, so the play Peter Pan came out of this novel. You know, it's been on Broadway several times, touring companies and such. So a little bit of a different thing happens with Tinkerbell and her sort of near-death experience in the book.
Oh.
As opposed to what happens in the Disney film. You know, toward the end, Tinkerbell tries to save Peter, and Captain Hook has sent a bottle of poison to Peter to try to kill him, right? They're luring
This is
Wendy
in the movie
in
or the book?
In the book.
Okay,
in the book.
Okay, yes.
Yeah. So Captain Hook sends the poison. Tinkerbell knows it's there. She escapes Captain Hook's clutches and races in and drinks the poison before Peter can, and he's dying. She's dying. And in the book, now I can't remember, but we have to, basically Tinkerbell says the only thing that can save her is if people still believe in fairies.
Right.
And this lovely thing that happens in the play, because you're in the theater, that Peter says the only thing that can save her is if the people who are there applaud, like still believe in fairies and clap. You must clap, clap, clap. And so in like the early 80s, Sandy Duncan, so she played Peter Pan on Broadway and then in the touring company in the early 80s. And I got to see her do that. And it was so fun to go see that. But I remember clapping my little heart out when I was 10 or whatever.
Aww.
Yeah. Cause you got to save Tink. Cause even if she's like jerky and, I don't know, sassy, so sassy and insolent, you know, fairies are good. Got to keep them alive. And she sacrificed her life for Peter.
Yes.
So the other thing that I found out as I was sort of thinking about and talking about and sort of looking up other people's opinions of the book, Tinkerbell, was that this conversation I found on Reddit, which I had never considered but I think this makes a lot of sense. They were talking about the possibility that Peter Pan, the book, is all about Wendy hitting puberty. And that transition from being a little girl to being a teenager or being
a woman or mom or
or getting close to
Okay.
And that Tinkerbell is PMS.
Oh my gosh. Wow.
And at first I thought, oh boy. But then, you know, I thought about it and maybe not like directly that, but her crankiness, her not wanting to deal with dumbness, her, you know, you could read it that way. I sort of liked it.
Yeah.
Even if I don't know if I completely think that's exactly what it is.
Right. I don't think J.M. Barrie set out to write a book about a girl in puberty.
Yeah. I wonder. I mean, I wish that there was some scholarship. Maybe there is some scholarship around, you know, what he was, where he actually do know a little bit about where he was coming from when he wrote it, but because he lost a brother.
Yes.
Young. Did you read about that too?
Yeah.
You know, imagining his brother as a boy forever.
Yes. There you go.
As a sort of could be comforting and telling a story about that seems like a nice way to do it.
Right. Right. Yeah. I also read that J.M. Barrie, you know, he wrote a bunch of different novels that never really went anywhere. And then right before he was 40, he finally got into kind of that YA area where he started writing the young adult things for kids, and he found it very freeing. And that's when he started, you know, getting recognition and things like that.
Interesting.
For these novels that were directed more toward kids or for kids. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. But I love that that genre can speak to adults as well.
Oh, yes. Yeah. And speaking of that, like, I just listened to this book for the first time last week. Because you had, in preparation, you were like, oh, I love this book, J.M. Barrie, the Peter Pan. And first of all, I do have to say that, yes, Bryn, I can understand why you love this book, because in our books podcast, you talked about your love of writing, like how things were written and the language that things are written in. Like you just fall in love with that type of writing. And that definitely, like, there's some beautiful turns of phrases in here. And it's just really pretty. And I discovered that there's an audiobook version of Peter Pan where Jim Dale reads it. And he is the narrator to all the Harry Potter audiobooks. And he's just wonderful. So it was like an old friend stopped by and read me the book.
That's so beautiful. I love that. Jim Dale is fantastic.
He is. And I had to go seek it out because it's not on Audible. It's on audiobooks.com. So everyone, you can get a free trial for a week and listen to Jim Dale read Peter Pan.
Perfect.
But what I found interesting, what really struck me about this book beyond Tinkerbell. So you talked about Tinkerbell in this book. I'm going to go a little off base and just talk about Peter Pan, because for me, Peter Pan the film wasn't a big thing in my life. I maybe watched it once, but I was the right age when Hook came out. Hook the movie from 1991. Yes. And I know this movie much better than Peter Pan. And it was interesting to see some of the novel being weaved into Hook. And I'm, of course, looking at it backwards. Because, you know, Steven Spielberg and all the people working on Hook had read the book first. But, like, even the opening scene of Hook is Wendy and Peter's little meet cute from the book, you know, because they're recreating the play that you saw, Bryn.
Right.
So
right. Yes.
They have that thimble kiss, and
yes.
Also, it replays the scene, like Hook replays the scene from the ending of Peter Pan, where it's kind of the epilogue where they're talking about how Peter Pan returns once a year, but his year is much different. And so he'll return several years later and Wendy has a kid, and then that kid has a kid. And so that's like replayed in Hook.
Yeah.
And then also they read from the J.M. Barrie novel. So Granny Wendy is reading to Peter Banning, who is Robin Williams, Peter's daughter. And she reads this part of the book.
All children, except one, grow up. Now you know where fairies come from, don't you, Maggie? When the first baby laughed for the first time, the laugh broke into a thousand pieces, and they all went skipping about. That was the beginning of fairies. And look. I'm Wendy. It was a long time ago.
The Jack says you're not the really real Wendy.
Ah, well, you see where Jack is? Hmm? Well, that is the same window. And this is the same room where we made up bedtime stories about Peter and Neverland and scary old Captain Hook. And do you know, Mr. Barry was Sir James. Our neighbor, he loved our stories so much that he wrote them all down in a book. Oh, dear me, 80 years ago.
You're really old.
That's very true.
It's such a good movie.
Mm-hmm. But I love, there's your turn of phrase that you love. And the fairies went skipping about.
Yes.
And of course it's Maggie Smith who becomes, what's her name from Harry Potter?
McGonagall, Professor McGonagall.
Thank you. Yeah.
Phew.
But, and I remember back then I was like, wow, she looks so old. But she plays, oh, she's amazing. I love Maggie Smith.
Yeah. That movie is so good. I don't think I saw it until I was an adult,
mm-hmm.
for whatever reason, but oh gosh, it's filled with so much emotion and it's such a touching movie and it's so much fun.
It is. And we'll talk about it a little more later, especially Tinkerbell, but I just wanted to bring up one more part that I, like, when I heard this in the Peter Pan novel, I, like, freaked out. So there's one point in the Peter Pan novel where Peter Pan is, you know, he gets lost in these adventures. He has so many of them. He doesn't really, like, Captain Hook, he vanquishes him, and then he forgets about Captain Hook because he's on to the next adventure.
Yeah.
And so there's one point where I think it's Captain Hook is about to kill Peter Pan, and Peter Pan's like, ah, whatever. To die will be an awfully big adventure, right?
Yes.
And this like slapped me in the face because there's a moment in Hook where Robin Williams as Peter Pan says this.
So, your adventures are over.
Oh no. To live will be an awfully big adventure.
Yeah.
It's good.
That's like, oh my God, what a way to flip it around. And all, I mean, God, I still haven't been able to get through the whole movie Hook since Robin Williams died because of that line. Like,
sure. Yep. Yep. I love that they did that they took, because I love that line. I love the original line in the book. You know, it's this young boy who's gonna live forever and has no actual cares and is dramatic and is like, yes, to die will be a great adventure, and he's gonna pretend to die, right? Or whatever. And it's so perfect for that, for the book. And then the fact that they took it and spun it and made it so perfect for the film.
Right.
And then perfect, they had no idea how it would affect things later in time.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. So I had to bring that up because, yeah. So thank you. Thank you for, you know, having me read Peter Pan.
Sure. Thank you for taking it on.
Yay. All right. So was that all you had about that one?
I think so. Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, one thing about Jim Dale, is he the one who plays the villain in Pete's Dragon?
Yes, he is.
The original one. Okay, yes. So that's really what I know him from, because I, for some reason, the audiobooks that we got originally of Harry Potter is someone else reading it. I forget who it is, but they're just so expensive that I haven't purchased the Jim Dale ones because whatever, we had other ones.
Gotcha.
But he's wonderful. Oh my gosh. Dr. Cornelius, no, that's not what it is. I forget what his name is in that.
Oh,
movie,
yeah. He is good, though. He, like, so, chews the scenery.
So good. Oh, yeah. He's the best thing in that movie. Yeah.
Yeah. And his outfits and like, it must have been really hot too, because he's like always sweating.
Yes. Yes.
But they make him wear these crazy, like multi-layer things with capes and stuff.
Yeah. 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 So cool. Good. Love him. Love him. Love him.
Yay.
Okay. But yes, that's all I had, I think, about the original book, Tinkerbell.
All right. So let's talk about now. Let's see. So let's jump to 1953. So we were in 1911. We're going to go to 1953 now with...
Big jump.
Yes. With Peter Pan, the Disney film, and Tinkerbell from that movie.
Walt Disney Pictures presents...
Peter Pan!
Where pixie dust began. And the adventure took flight.
How do we get to Neverland?
Fly, of course.
Say your prayers, or I'll get you for this bag.
The timeless story of a boy who never grows up and a magical journey to a land where dreams come true.
Oh, Peter, you saved my life.
All it takes is faith and trust and just a little bit of pixie dust.
Here we go!
The original Peter Pan.
This is the one most of us probably were first introduced to, depending on how old we are.
Exactly, yeah. And I mean, when you think of Tinkerbell, you probably think of this Tinkerbell, the like little petite blonde pixie hair sprite in the green dress.
Yep. That with looks, the little white pom-poms on her shoes.
Yes, that looks like Marilyn Monroe, kind of, with the little curvy.
Yep. sassy, curvy little blonde.
Yep. Yeah, that's her. Yay. All right. Yeah. So, I don't know, should I go?
Because you are Jedi Tink, I kind of feel, and although, I mean, so here's a question.
Okay.
Are you Jedi Tink because of the hook Tinkerbell then?
No. And we'll get there.
Okay. 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 So yeah. So let's, why don't you start with the animated Peter Pan Disney Tinkerbell?
Okay. Okay. So this is interesting. In fact, you're kind of touching on it. Yes. My big character is Jedi Tink and I'm at Jedi Tink on social media and things, but it's not because of this film. And maybe I should just insert my story here because I was going to say it later. But I think it's good to know. I'll just say that, like, Peter Pan was not a big film for me. I didn't like the Tinkerbell and Hook, and we'll get to that. But the reason why I identify with Tinkerbell so much is because in 2001, I visited the animation building in DCA, and they had the Beast Library there. And that is where you can take your little character quiz and see what Disney character you're most like. Right? And at this point, I'm in college, and we like go every weekend to Disneyland, like a bunch of friends. Like we're always there. And so we always like, you know, find the interesting little things to do. And this was one thing that I did. And the very first time I took this quiz, I got Tinkerbell. And I was like, okay. And I thought about it. And like, so I've always loved Belle as my favorite princess until there was Tangled. But then I thought about it and I thought, well, Tink kind of, she looks like me. You know, she's small, she's curvy, a little bit attitude-y, you know. and so I kind of took the night to think about it. And then I realized that I really liked her and she was cemented as my favorite Disney character. And I went out the next day and bought a shirt of Tinkerbell at Disneyland. And that was that.
Wow. I love that.
Yeah. And it was mostly because of, well, first of all, it's like what she looked like. She's just so cute and adorable. And
so cute.
And I think they had a lot of merchandise at that time, too, with like her on the shirts. I have this one shirt I can't fit into anymore, but it's really cute and I keep it. That's where she comes from. And it's mostly her kind of personality as it pertains to like the parks, really. Like how she's the icon of the parks and not necessarily her character in Peter Pan, the film. So.
Right, right. Yeah, she is sort of her own thing in the parks. She's really taken on this whole other dimension, which I love.
Right, and I think that's what drew me to her, too, is, like, she's, like, the emblem of Disneyland. And at that time, I was kind of falling in love with the parks myself, going there so often for the first time in my life. So there you go. There's my love.
That's so cool. Yeah. I can't believe that I never knew that story. I'm so glad we did this show.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. So I always find it amusing because people will send me like Peter Pan stuff and I'll be like, oh, that's cool. I'm not going to get it. I'm not a Peter Pan fan. I'm a Tink fan. So
right, right. I love it.
But I do appreciate that people think of me though. So bring on the Peter Pan stuff.
Got it. Got it. I do love Peter Pan. I mean, there's a lot of cultural stuff in there that we have to talk through,
right?
You know, which I'm grateful that Disney has put that statement at the beginning, because I just actually watched some of Peter Pan today to prepare for this show,
right?
And I'm glad that they put the statement on about cultural.
Yes, I believe it says like this may contain cultural references that are out of date, something, something. Please be advised.
That's right.
Something, something. Yes.
That's right.
And yes, it's very like dated. Yeah. Richard and I in the last year since Disney Plus, you know, we've watched it and we're like, whoa.
Oof. Yeah.
Oof. Yeah. So it is a bit of a cultural gap between 1953 and 2021.
Yes. Yes.
But that being said, Tinkerbell herself in this movie, that's who we're talking about. Like I said, we watched it recently and I was a little appalled because beyond that gorgeous scene where you meet her for the first time and she's like walking on the mirror and looking at herself.
Yes.
Like, noticing how big of a, a little butt she has.
How curvy and delightfully curvy she is.
Yes, exactly.
Yes. Yes.
But she like in this film straight up tries to murder Wendy. Like, Tink is not very likable. I was appalled. No. Yeah. Yeah. So what was your impressions of her in this film?
Same with she's adorable and I love to watch her move and I do love her sassiness to a point. But she is a little bit of a villain. Mm-hmm. You know? But then she's also treated so, so badly by Captain Hook. Mm.
Oh, that's you know,
right. He manipulates her. So he totally manipulates her because of her feelings for Peter and turns her even more against Wendy and just traps her and like all sorts. It's, she's treated so badly, but she comes through in the end for Peter, right? You know, in the book, you know, she drinks the poison that's meant for him. In the movie, she grabs the box that has the bomb in it that Hook has taken or has Hook has sent to him and she basically blows up.
Oh my gosh.
But not like you don't see that. And the bomb explodes and then she's thrown into the rubble and so she sacrifices herself for Peter to save his life. And then he finds her, he digs through and finds her. And they don't really show this, but he says,
"Hold on, Tink, hold on. Don't go out. Don't you understand, Tink? You mean more to me than anything in this whole world."
Mm. And that's the thing that brings her back to life. So in the book and the play, people believing in fairies and clapping bring her back to life or restore her life.
Right.
In the movie, because they can't turn to us and say, you gotta clap. Believe in fairies, clap. I mean, they could have, but they weren't doing that at the time, I guess.
Right.
Anyway, Peter telling her that she's the most important thing to him in the world brings her back. But they don't really say that in the film. It's not that explicit. I did watch that scene today, which I think was, I thought that was interesting. Like, she's blown up. Oh, Peter's digging through the rubble. Things are falling. He says, "You mean more to me than anything in this whole world." And then we're on the boat with the Lost Boys and Captain Hook and his crew and Wendy, and they're being tied up and, oh no, Wendy's gonna be taken away. And suddenly Peter shows up and Tink shows up too to save them. So it was handled. That was strange.
Okay. They didn't allow the time for that kind of little emotional beat.
Yeah. They didn't sort of explain. Yeah. They didn't explain. Like, we never see Tink come out from where she is.
Oh.
When he says that to her, it's strange.
Huh.
But Tinkerbell herself, adorable, fun. And the thing about this movie for me is that we had the record album of the movie when I was a kid.
Okay.
And so these were like big records and they came in a big album and it had a book in with the album. I don't know if you've ever seen any of those, but it's like a full album sized book.
I've heard a lot about them from like Nostalgia and others.
Got it. So we had Peter Pan. We had a bunch of them, but Peter Pan was one of my favorites. So I just loved to play it and like sit on, lay on my belly in front of the record player and look through the pages and the pictures of Tinkerbell and the sounds that it made. Oh, and then so also right around that time, there were all these audiobooks that were on cassette where you got a little book. It's like a small book and then a cassette tape, and the cassette tape had the recording of someone reading the book to you.
Oh, nice.
And when you were supposed to turn the page, it would, Tinkerbell's little bells would be the key, the cue to turn the page.
Right.
That sound is just in my soul. And I love it so much. And I desperately want, like, I need it to be my ringtone or something. You know, like, I know that some people, I've heard it on podcasts and stuff. I need to seek it out for myself because that Tinkerbell lives in my soul in so many different ways, and that's one of the big ones is the sound of her bells.
Well, one of the coolest things to come out of the Peter Pan Disney film is the animator's reference model for Tinkerbell, which is Margaret Carey. And
yes,
she is 92 years young this year. And
woohoo!
I know. And she is just a lovely woman. You've met her too, right? Yes.
I have not met her in person, but I've listened to your episodes and I've seen, she's been on sort of video things that I've watched but I've never met her in person.
Oh, okay. Well, she's just darling. She's just as cute and tiny as you would imagine and just as spunky as well. And, you know, she was a dancer back then in the 50s and in her very early 20s. And so they had her come in the studio and do the little pantomime movements. And she says she didn't have to wear makeup. So she was very excited about that.
That's so a good cute. Day.
Yeah. And she was in her little swimsuit and she didn't want to meet Walt Disney in her little swimsuit. I mean, back in the 50s, I was like, ooh, crazy. Anyway, but there's so many cute stories that she shared. And you can find her on episodes 15 and 16 of Skywalking Through Neverland, as well as several more later. But we'll tell you about those later, because she became kind of our fairy pod mother.
To everybody out there, I would like to say, I'm sending you faith and trust. And here's a whole bunch of pixie dust.
So I hope you get to meet her. Although she's
that would
moved
be lovely. I know
now.
She lives in Florida. Yeah, she lives in Florida now. She got married.
She did,
and moved to Florida. It's so beautiful.
I know. I love that. Oh,
yeah.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
All right. So now let's move on. Okay. So Peter Pan is 1953. Now in 1954, all of a sudden, you have Walt Disney. He wants to market Disneyland because Disneyland's going to open in 1955. And so he has, you know, he's trying to get Disneyland Park off the ground. And he was advised not to use Mickey Mouse as the park icon. Now, I know this story because Margaret Carey told it. She's very full of stories. So if you ever do get a chance to talk with her, just ask her one question and off she goes. But
well, she's had a long, long, rich life with plenty of stories, I'm sure, built up.
Very, very much so. And so she was telling us that, yes, Walt Disney was advised not to use Mickey Mouse as the park icon in case it was a failure for some reason. I mean, you think about that now, it's like, of course not. But you never know.
Yeah.
I mean,
no, yeah, it makes sense. Yeah. It makes sense.
So instead, he decided to use Jiminy Cricket and Tinkerbell. And now, when you think of Disneyland, do you think of Jiminy Cricket?
No.
No. No, he's quickly kind of, Tinkerbell took the top spot there. She ended up being the main park icon. And she actually debuted in 1954 on Walt's Disneyland TV series to introduce the TV series Four Realms, of Disneyland. And then you also see, of course, see her at the opening of that, you know, animated in the opening of that series, which is cool.
Oh, I have not watched those. Are they available on Disney Plus?
There's like only one or two that are available, but okay. It's very much like there's the castle and Tink like appears and she's animated in this little cute sequence. And then occasionally she was animated into the show, like with Walt Disney in live action.
Oh,
like,
yeah,
just very briefly. But like, yeah, she's there sometimes.
That's cool. Yeah. That's so fun.
It is. It is. And then I do have to touch on, you know, Tinkerbell is a Disneyland park icon. Well, from 1983 to 2005, a woman played Tinkerbell flying over the castle. She went from the Matterhorn all the way over the castle to like this platform on the other side. And we've all seen her, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was a big, huge thing for me when we would go and stay late enough to see that at the end of the day.
Oh.
So fun. So thrilling.
Yes.
So thrilling.
It is. And it's fantastic. And Gina Rock is the woman who played that flying Tinkerbell. And oh, wait, we've interviewed her on Skywalking Through Neverland as well. I hope this doesn't sound too much like an ad. But anyway.
You have so many things that are relevant to this episode. It's totally fair.
Because Tinkerbell, right? Yeah.
Right? Yeah.
So she's on episode 191. And incidentally, I just found this out yesterday when I was doing these show notes, but a search for Gina Rock on Google, our interview is the first that video that pops up with little like key moments and timestamps shown. So like,
ooh,
super cool, Google. That was awesome.
Right on. Woohoo.
I know. I was like, wow, that's neat. And that's also why you put podcasts on YouTube, even if you do have an audio only show, because it's great for search.
All right. Yeah. YouTube is this number two search engine in the world.
Yay. Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that's Google is number one. YouTube is number two.
Wow. Well, doesn't Google
make sense?
Own? Yeah. They own YouTube.
They do. They do. But I think there's the separate algorithms or something. I'm not sure how it works.
Okay. Interesting. All right.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. So I don't know if any of you listeners have seen Gina Rock the Flying Tinkerbell or any of the Tinkerbells flying over Disneyland. It's really a special moment, I think.
It is.
Yeah.
Especially if you're not expecting it and suddenly you're like, that's Tinkerbell.
Yeah, I guess
flying.
So. Well, also, if you think about it, I mean, like I was raised on Disney films, not necessarily the parks because I did not live in a parks state. So like, you know, every Disney movie begins with the castle and the little Tinkerbell flying over it. So when you see it,
yes,
live in front of you, you're like, what?
Yeah, it's real.
I know. Amazing. So it's,
yeah,
it's
yeah,
very cool. All right. Well, now we're going to jump ahead to 1991 and the movie Hook. So we've talked aww about it a little bit, but this is the film. It was directed by Steven Spielberg. You have Robin Williams as Peter Banning, who is actually Peter Pan grown up. And Julia Roberts is Tinkerbell.
Yeah.
Okay. Should I get into this?
Yeah. We should just dive in.
Okay. So, all right. Ding, ding, ding. This gets the nod as the worst Tinkerbell portrayal ever. Because, yeah. I mean, Tink, she's tiny and cute. You don't cast, like, the statuesque, very long-limbed woman as Tinkerbell and then squash this pixie-cut red wig on her head that doesn't...
The wig is the...
It's terrible.
Oh, it's the worst.
Now, I was 10 when I saw this film, and I... Even me, I was like, she was so unbelievable as like this tiny being talking to Peter. Like it was obvious to me that they had done these insert shots where they shot her.
Yeah.
And then because I knew her too well, like you can't cast someone who's so well known in that role, I think was the issue. Cause even
yeah,
me at 10,
too.
I was like, oh, well, that's Pretty Woman, you know, like.
Yeah. Yeah.
And she's not small either. She's not tiny. She's not cute. And then I think
yeah,
I was like sensing this lack of chemistry between her and Robin Williams mm-hmm too, because in this film, they really up the whole, like, she's in love with Peter kind of a thing.
Yeah.
She's got this crush on Peter Pan. Yeah. And I did not like that. I think partly though, that was because I had kind of imprinted on Robin Williams and I loved him, you know, in my kid way. So I was like, who are you to love him? No, you know, I was being Tinkerbell.
You're the actual Tink. Yeah.
Exactly.
Like, you're Tinking Tink.
So I do have to bring up the fact that my mom and I both felt this way. Like, I remember talking to her about it after the film, and there's this one line in the movie that I think we both laughed out loud in the theater when Tinkerbell says this to Peter, and it is this one.
You know that place between sleep and awake? That place where you still remember dreaming? That's where I'll always love you, Peter Pan. That's where I'll be waiting.
Why make it so overt?
I know. You know that place between sleep and awake, Peter? Oh my God, we've made fun of that line so many times.
I wonder, too, if they were ever together.
Yeah.
Like
that, too.
Maybe it's possible that they couldn't vibe off each other because they weren't acting opposite each other.
I think you're absolutely right about that, because even that one line, like Peter is on the bottom of the statue and she's like supposed to be sitting on top of the statue. And so, yeah, they intercut their lines. Yeah. There's many scenes where she's like in her little house or something and he's looking in. But yeah, you're right.
I wonder if that's what was part of the problem.
Mm-hmm. Wow. You said you've seen this film.
I have, yeah. I've seen it a handful of times. I really love it. It's beautiful. It's so different from all the other Peter Pan-y stuff we have.
Right.
Robin Williams is fantastic.
Yeah.
It hits me in many of the same ways that the book hits me and makes me cry. Mm. It's very, very good. And there's so many sort of lines and phrases and moments that people who've seen the movie can rally behind, you know, like Bangarang and
Rufio.
Rufio, yeah.
Fun fact, Bangarang Day. So Bangarang is like what all the Lost Boys say and like things appear and stuff like that. Or Bangarang, Peter, Bangarang, you know, and it's kind of their rallying cry. And I was so I actually saw this film with my talented and gifted class. So I was like in the talented and gifted math and English class in my fifth grade in school. And so our fifth grade class, we all went and saw this film together. And then we had like a dress as a pirate day and we had a bangarang day. And so we had to like dress as pirates. We like put on a play. We had to like make a treasure chest and then fill it with things. And one of the things we had to fill it with was whipped cream that we had colored, like dyed different colors.
Oh, yeah.
And we
actually had
like a whipped cream fight, like outside. We all had to wear like, you know, like
trash bags or something.
Exactly. Trash bags that we had made and stuff. But yeah, we had like bangarang and we like threw this colored whipped cream at each other. So it was like the food fight.
How fun.
It was
amazing that they let you do that.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. We had an awesome teacher and like an awesome time. And yeah, it always felt like we were playing hooky from our regular classes because we had to leave our regular classes to go to that particular class. Anyway, it was awesome. It was so cool. So
that's so cool. And what a great way to stamp that movie on your heart, you know?
Yeah.
Being able to live it a little bit after. That's really cool. Yeah. And to have that communal experience.
Yeah, it was awesome. And then I do have to note that I think John Williams also had a lot to do with the fact that I love this film too. Because there's like five themes in this film that are just incredible. And it's lovely.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, he never disappoints, that John Williams.
No, he doesn't. Yay.
Yay for Hook.
I know. So good. Okay, I have to watch it again now. I think I'm over. I think I can watch it now. I got through that one clip.
Yeah.
So we can do it.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And it's a wonderful way to honor him.
That's very true. Yay.
And spend some time with him.
Yeah. Oh, okay. I love that way of thinking. All right. So Should we move ahead to the Tinkerbell films?
Yeah, yeah. These are my favorite. This is my favorite way to experience Tinkerbell, I think.
Yay. Okay. So I'm going to lay it out for you and then you'll go. I want to hear about your experience because you have kids at this point and you've shared some pictures with me last night. I'm like, ooh, I want to hear about these stories. So,
yeah.
So we have the Tinkerbell films. Now these movies, there were 7 of them released from 2008 to 2014, and these were done by Disney Toon Studios, so they were direct-to-video. But I think they were so fantastic that they could have been theatrical releases easily.
Have you ever wondered how nature gets its glow? Who gives it light and color as the seasons come and go? It's all the work of fairies. Here, every day is filled with adventure.
What do you think? Too big?
And the best way to find magic is with your friends.
Come on, girls. It's showtime!
Fly to who you are. Climb upon your star. You believe you'll find your wings fly.
Great to have friends that'll help you out.
You have to meet Tinkerbell!
What?
Who?
Nice to meet you.
I'm a tinker. Tinkers fix things, but I can't do it alone.
Faith.
Trust.
Whoa. And pixie dust.
See more of Tinkerbell and her friends in these Disney fairy movies. You can find out more at DisneyFairies.com.
So let's get into these films. So Bryn, what is your experience?
Okay, so the first one was in 2008, and I had my first kid in 2006. Ooh. So I believe we didn't discover these until 2009 or 2010, but I don't remember how we discovered them, but I know I bought them on DVD.
Okay. Oh, what?
So
no, I'm just kidding.
Yeah. What's a DVD?
Right?
So, because my daughter was three, four, we finally were letting her watch stuff. We waited for a long time. And these seemed like a good entry to movies. And we just absolutely fell in love with them. I did not expect to enjoy them as much as I did. She liked them also, but I really was just like, these are amazing. And what I really liked about, especially the first one. So the first one is called Tinkerbell, and it's her origin story, which I thought was so clever and so, what a great way to introduce us and to pull us into this world. And we get to meet, so it's Tinkerbell, you know, a baby laughs, splits into whatever, and spins out to,
like a pussy willow? Is it like a pussy willow that she?
It's like, I don't think, no, it's not a pussy willow. It's like this white fluff thing with a, like a little dangly seed thing.
Okay.
That spins. And so what's really beautiful. So the laugh splits and then goes through London and picks up this little piece of plant fluff.
Right.
And carries it all the way to Pixie Hollow, and it lands in front of the pixie dust tree, I think. And it sort of falls down, and then Tinkerbell kind of sits up at, like, comes up out of it and sits up. But the way that the fluff is,
looks like a skirt.
Basically,
right?
She's, yeah, it's a skirt, and she's basically dressed as this fluff as a person. It's the cutest thing. And her hair is down.
Yes.
It's just darling. They totally captured my imagination. And I just loved the world that they created for these fairies. And the friendships. So the Tinkerbell series is really about friends, being good friends, understanding and finding out who you are.
Right.
And doing that the best you can. Helping each other. It's really these wonderful lessons that are done in such a beautiful place. They made the world that they live in so fun and gorgeous and
beautiful. Yeah.
I just love it. And it's just, the fact that it's direct to video, they did a nice job on it. It's not just some junky slap it together kind of thing.
No, it's 3D animation as well. And what's interesting about it, also you're talking about those lessons between friendship. I think also another lesson that's very good is the fact that you can love and be friends with people who are different from you. Because all these fairies, like one of the main quests of the first film is for Tinkerbell to find her talent. And each of the fairies have different talents. And so you have Rosetta. She's a garden fairy voiced by Kristen Chenoweth. You have Silvermist, who is a water fairy voiced by Lucy Liu. You have Iridessa, who is a light fairy. So she can harness light. She's voiced by Raven Simone. And then Fawn is an animal fairy who is voiced by America Ferrera. And Tinkerbell herself is voiced by Mae Whitman. And this is the first time Tinkerbell has a voice.
Right.
And that's like amazing.
Big deal.
Yeah.
And I do think it's so, so cool and so interesting that they were able to get big name actresses to play a lot of these roles. And then later as the films go on. And like Angelica Houston is Queen Clarion.
Yeah. Like amazing.
And in subsequent films, very famous people are playing these characters, which is really neat. I love that. Mm-hmm. And they do a nice job, I think.
Like the pirate fairy you have, right? Christina Hendricks.
The pirate fairy. Christina Hendricks. Yes.
And Tom Hiddleston is
Captain Hook. And Tom Hiddleston is James Hook.
It's your boyfriend.
Well then, we won't need you anymore.
Our plan worked perfectly. Fairies are such gullible creatures.
Aren't they, lads?
No match for an Eton education such as mine.
Oh, what? He's a smart one.
The power of the pixie dust is finally ours. Yes.
Oh my god. So I didn't know that he was this character for years. I don't know how I didn't know. Maybe I didn't even know Tom Hiddleston existed when it came out.
Probably.
When the Pirate Fairy came out.
Well, let's see. Anyway, that came out in 2014. Yeah.
2014. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Anyway, he does a great job.
Yeah.
Super fun.
Oh, yeah. I mean, come on. Captain Hook. How fun is that? Dustin Hoffman had a great time playing him in Hook. So.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I just love these movies. And each one of them is great for its own reasons. Mm-hmm. They're like Tinkerbell and the Lost Treasure, she really values Terrence, her sort of best friend.
Yes, that's right.
Who she's kind of been fairly nasty to.
Exactly.
In some ways.
Right.
And I love that this Tinkerbell, she's still salty and, you know, has a temper but she's also very sweet and she's trying to learn, she's great. She's very relatable.
Yes, absolutely. And actually looking at these lineup of films, Pixie Hollow Games, I don't think I ever saw this film.
So that one was weird because it was not released on DVD, I don't think. And I'm not even sure how you could see it. It was on a particular Disney channel, maybe when they had different channels or something. I don't know. So we never saw this until I think I found it on YouTube or something years later.
Oh, is it on Disney Plus?
I think it is. Yes.
Oh, well, that's my next thing. Writing that down.
That one I didn't like as much as the rest.
Okay.
And it's a short. It's not like a full feature.
Okay.
I think it's a long short, but it's not a full feature.
Huh.
And then my favorite is The Great Fairy Rescue.
Ooh.
Oh, have you seen that one?
I have.
It's so good.
I have. So this is the one where she goes to the mainland, right? And
yes, and they get to go to the mainland.
Befriends a girl.
She does. She gets captured accidentally, sort of. And she lives in a house with a girl for a while. And that one is all about, oh, parents and kids.
Oh, that's true. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And that one is sort of our family favorite. Even Elon loves that one. When, if we think, hey, let's watch a Tinkerbell movie, he will always be like, let's watch The Great Fairy Rescue. It's about a dad, a single dad who is struggling to keep his, do his job and raise his daughter and isn't always paying any attention to her. And she has a very rich life, fantasy life, and is very interested in fairies. Mm. And it was right around that time. So that was released in 2010.
Right.
And that was the year I had my second kid. And so when it was my daughter's birthday, the 15-year-old at the time, she was turning 5. For her birthday, we did a fairy tea party, birthday party. And so, which was really fun. So the girls all dressed like fairies and we had a fancy tea set up and we made a fairy circle cake.
Oh, wow.
So with mushrooms, with like, meringue mushrooms in a circle on the cake. And I forget what else we did. I did face painting and we probably did other things. I forget now, but it was very fun and magical. And all the girls had wings and it was just fun and cozy. Can we have a party like that? Just us?
Yes.
Let's have a fairy tea party.
A fairy party. I'll have to make your cake again. And mm-hmm. Yep. We'll all wear wings.
Yes.
Got my wings right back there. And
no, I don't have any wings anymore. I'll have to get some wings.
That's okay. I have spare.
Oh, good. I would love to borrow.
And that reminds me, because at this time I was doing a lot of kids' parties as an entertainer, and I got to play plenty of fairies in green dresses. And in blue dresses and in pink dresses, kind of fun. Like, yeah, yeah, it was so much fun. And
so,
yes, go ahead.
In the next movie after this one, that was The Secret of the Wings,
yes.
Where she meets her sister, which I also love. Like, I love that they add this extra thing, like, oh, by the way, you didn't realize it, but it's split into two and they're twins or whatever. Sorry, spoiler alert. And so her name is Periwinkle.
Yes.
And so did you ever play Periwinkle?
Yeah, I got lots of requests for blue fairies. Yeah, fairies in blue dresses. Yeah.
Yes.
So yes, that too. And then also conventions as well. You know, there was a lot of groups of girls playing all the different fairies and boys, you know, playing all the different characters from these films. And that, oh my gosh, when I saw them, I was like, oh, it's amazing. Cause I would generally do my Jedi Tink, but like, then I'd have to get a picture with like the pirate fairy or like all the fairies.
Sure.
I'm sure I have pictures somewhere with like the whole group. Right? Like at D23.
Yeah, I would love to see.
D23 expos and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. That's so fun.
So awesome.
We had like all the toys, all the little fairy doll toys. They had little six inch toys, which is about how tall they're supposed to be. The fairies are about 5.5, 6 inches. And I think we got rid of the 6-inch ones, but we have these little tiny ones too. And I still have those. Like, I'm not getting rid of these. I love these things. I've got Clean Clarion and everybody. I love the fairies.
You'll have to share pictures on Instagram.
Yeah, I'll have to find them. They're in a little bag.
Okay.
They're in a little bag in a drawer somewhere, but I'll have to find them.
Ooh, I want to see that.
But
I want to see that.
The other thing about these movies is they have great songs.
Yeah.
They did sort of pop songs and other songs, throughout them. In each of the movies has a pop version of the sort of theme song. And they're actually pretty good. I like actually listen to them by myself in the car without kids sometimes and sing along.
Aww. Wow. I need to go back and listen to some of these. I love this, Bryn. This is a whole new side of you.
Bryn. And you know, it's funny because I was never a fairy kid, you know, back in when I was young. I like Tinkerbell, but these fairies definitely woke something up in me.
You're woke now.
I'm fairy woke.
Yeah. I love it. Oh my God. Hashtag that. Okay. I do have to say that, like you were having kids and watching these fairy movies. Well, I was having a podcast and watching these fairy movies. And so we invited Margaret Carey, the animator's reference model, to come on and like review the films with us, which was super fun. It was great to get her take on these. And yeah.
I know I listened to this episode, but I'm forgetting what she said.
I think she reviewed a couple of them with us.
Okay.
So the later ones that would be like The Pirate Fairy and Tinkerbell and The Legend of the Never Beast.
I think I remember you guys talking about the Never Beast one.
Yes. And that is my note on these films. Once you watch Tinkerbell and The Legend of the Never Beast, you don't need to watch it again. Oh my God. It's such a downer. It's like so depressing.
Yeah. I think I only watched that one once.
Yeah.
All the way through. And then earlier today, I was sort of skipping around trying to remind myself what this movie was about, and I didn't get to the end.
No. No, I was like literally bawling at the end of this film. Like, I don't want to like everyone go look up what the synopsis is about, because it's such a downer. It's this Never Beast, and the Never Beast, well, he's only around for so long. And anyway,
it's a little bit like E.T.
Yes, very good. Yeah,
yeah, or you know, like Mary Poppins or Pete's Dragon.
Yeah,
but in maybe a slightly different way.
Right, right. Yeah. But other than that, everyone go watch these films. They're adorable. They're on Disney Plus. And yeah. I started watching the first one the other day. I was like, oh, I remember. Oh, so cute. Oh, the fairy talents.
Yeah.
What talent would you have?
I know, right? Well, I think I'm a tinker fairy.
Oh, okay. Nice.
Yeah.
Hmm.
What would you be?
Oh, my gosh. What would I want to be versus what would I really be, right?
Right, right, right.
Because I think I'd want to be like a light fairy, because that just sounds like fancy and cool.
Yeah, yeah. It's fun.
But I'm sure there's quizzes.
And there's other talents too. Just right. The main characters have certain talents, but there's other talents also.
Yeah. I always thought the garden fairy was pretty, but I would not be a garden fairy. Oh, the animal talent fairy. The animal talent.
Yeah,
I'd love
Fawn.
To be that. Like, Fawn. As a kid, I could see me, like, very much gravitating toward Fawn.
Yeah, yeah. She's great.
Yeah.
They're in the Pixie Hollow area of Disneyland, where you can meet the fairies. I wonder if they still have that. I haven't even looked.
I don't think it's in use right now. They do have it. But yeah.
But it still exists.
Mm-hmm.
We went when my daughter was young, and the fairies you were meeting that day were Tinkerbell and Fawn.
Aww.
And Tinkerbell, whatever was going on with Tinkerbell, either they were switching, she had to take a break or something. But so it was taking a really long time for us to move on to Tinkerbell. We saw Fawn first. And Fawn was so amazing. Once she realized that it was going to be a little while, she just sat down cross-legged and invited my kid to sit down across from her. And they just talked. Like, we were in there for probably 10-15 minutes, and they just talked about whatever, and I just stood off to the side just being like, this is amazing. It was so cool. And then we eventually got into Tinkerbell, and we were like, hey, hi, yeah, you, okay, let's take a picture, okay, bye. We had a full Fawn experience. We're good.
That's so funny. How old was your daughter at that point?
Probably, let's see, 6.
Oh, nice.
7.
Yeah.
Yeah, so young.
That's awesome. Oh,
yeah,
so
it was
cool.
Marvelous.
Yay, yeah. I'm so glad they gave the fairies voices.
Yes, it's great. And they're all, yeah, they're just, it's wonderful. I love this series. I want to have a marathon of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and a tea party.
Tea party marathon.
Awesome. Let's do it. And then read a book.
We're doing it.
And then go watch the space station. And then what was our first episode about?
Wearing beautiful lipstick.
Yes. There you go.
It's a totally tell me everything extravaganza.
I love it. Oh my gosh. Wow. All right. Wow. Well, that was our first question, everyone. An hour later.
Oh my goodness. You poor, poor people. Oof.
But that's okay, because we don't have too much. Like, that was our main big chunk. And now we just want to kind of share a little bit about what we want to learn about this episode. And it's not too much, even though my notes look long. It's not that much.
I will not remain daunted.
Okay, good. All right, so what do we want to learn about fairies and or Tinkerbell? Well, I think we learned a lot about Tinkerbell. So now we're going to dive into fairies a little bit. And basically, I want to kind of know the types of fairies that have appeared kind of in folklore over time. And there's very definitive types. So before we dive into this, like, first we have to ask ourselves, and you listeners and Bryn, I'm going to ask you, how would you describe a fairy today in 2021? If you had to describe a fairy to someone, what would you say?
I would say that a fairy is a supernatural or mythical being that is small and human looking and has wings and is either mischievous or cares or tends for some sort of element of nature or the world.
Okay.
Or is evil.
Oh my. Okay. So you would even say she's evil. Okay. Because I think most people wouldn't really say that fairies are evil. But,
well, I think there are different kinds of fairies, and I think sometimes they're evil fairies.
Right. All right. So perfect. So that was a very good description. And that's touching on like several different types of fairies, actually. So fairies kind of have appeared in folklore from all over the world as, like what you said, kind of supernatural or metaphysical beings, and who, if there's like the right conditions, they're able to interact with the physical world. So like even Tinkerbell herself, she comes from Neverland, which is not necessarily our world. It's like a different world, right? It's the world of dreams or something like that. And yet sometimes she interacts with the real world, like Wendy or the Great Fairy Rescue little girl, things like that.
Right. Right. Lizzie, that's her name.
Lizzie, there you go.
Lizzie.
Perfect. Okay. Well, one of the things you mentioned was that fairies were winged, and that's actually not very common back like in medieval times or things
or like
that.
Victorian.
Right. Victorian times is when they started to have more of the wings. Yes.
Got it.
Yeah.
And that's the sort of picture of them that we think of most when we think of like historical fairy stuff, right?
Exactly. Exactly.
Winged fairies. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So, but before that, like medieval times and things, fairies, even before like Christianity was kind of introduced into Europe and stuff, people really equated fairies with almost as gods or goddesses kind of a thing. That like had maybe fallen. And then when Christianity was introduced, all of a sudden fairies, they kind of switched and they were like, oh, well, fairies are creatures that aren't good enough to be in heaven. So they're bad. Right. So like immediately the church was like, okay, fairies are bad. They're pagan, blah, blah, blah. Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, and also I thought this was interesting that traditionally fairies have been mischievous, bad. They're also, you can classify leprechauns, ogres, and gnomes as fairies as well.
Oh,
so like the leprechauns are very mischievous, things like that. And so it all kind of boiled down to four different classifications for fairies throughout time. So you have the trickster fairies, and these are the ones that are like what you said, mischievous. They might pull pranks on humans. Sometimes they pull more sinister pranks that can lead to like humans' death, things like that. But leprechauns would fit in this category.
Cool. And an example of a mischievous fairy is from Shakespeare's play, A Midsummer Night's Dream.
And Puck? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Puck is definitely one of those.
Definitely. Okay. And is King Oberon? Is it?
Yes. Titania. That's all the fairies.
All the fairies. Okay.
King Oberon and Queen Titania. They're fairies.
Okay. Yep. Cool. Okay. Nice. Yeah. That's a very, very good example. And what's interesting is like people in medieval times, even a little bit after that, they would do things to protect themselves from these fairies, like actually do stuff. Like they would avoid, And this is mostly in the UK. So like Ireland, Scotland, yep. UK, Wales, they would avoid known fairy paths and they would avoid digging in fairy hills. Now, I don't know how you'd know what is a fairy path.
Identify a fairy hill or a fairy
path. Yeah, but apparently they did. And they would even knock the corners from their houses if a corner blocked a fairy path.
Wow, that's
dedicated. And then this is even more so. Cottages would actually be built with the front and the back doors in line with each other so that you could leave the doors open at night and let the fairies troop through so they wouldn't be trapped in your house and cause mischief. Right?
Because they can't find their way if it's not a straight path.
I guess, yeah. You just don't want them to get caught in your house.
Got it. And, no confusion. You just keep walking the same way you're walking.
Right. Don't no stopping
here. That's amazing.
And there was also thorn trees were considered fairy trees and you should not chop those down. And in fact, there was this one tree in Scotland that kind of blocked the expansion of a roadway, but they would not chop it down for 70 years. Because they didn't want to anger the fairies.
Whoa.
Mm-hmm. So tricksters, I mean, you kind of see a little bit of the mischievousness of them in Tinkerbell, and some fairies that we know today. But other than that, that's the trickster fairies. So now we have the second kind of classification of fairies are elementals. And if you think about it, elementals, automatically you think wind, water, light, air, kind of reminds you of the fairy films.
Sure.
But this is actually, the elemental fairies is not as popular a classification. And it's the theory that fairies were an intelligent species that was distinct from humans and angels. And there was this alchemist, Paracelsus, and he classified some of these gnomes and sylphs as elementals that were magical entities who would personify a particular force of nature and then exert power over those forces. So the wind, water, air, earth. And folklore accounts have described fairies as spirits of the air. So that makes me think of the Tinkerbell films and also Fantasia.
Oh, yeah.
Where you have the dance of the Sugar Plum Fairy. But the whole Nutcracker Suite is a lot of fairies in the elements, changing winter to spring and spring to, I'd said it the wrong way, right? Winter to spring.
I forget
spring to summer, summer to fall. Yeah. Yeah. And it's beautiful.
Yeah. That's probably one of my favorite parts of Fantasia.
Me too.
Is the fairy stuff. Yeah.
I love it. So I thought that was really cool. I was like, ooh, look.
Yeah.
Tinkerbell plucked that from time, right?
Yep. It makes sense.
All right. Well, we're getting to more. So then there's this classification of fairies that's changelings. And this kind of sounds very, very creepy. This would be people believed that fairies would steal a human baby and substitute it with a fairy one. And it was fairies abducting humans. They would abduct older people, if you left them alone, and women who had just given birth, all this weird stuff. It's whoa. And then if you think about it, this really came into the popular culture before the advent of modern medicine, when you had, babies who are born with maybe physiological conditions that are untreatable, or they didn't know how to classify it yet, right? Or children who are born with abnormalities, things like that. And so
trying to find
someone to blame. Yeah, some explanation. Yeah, yeah. They would blame fairies, this is a changeling baby or something. It's wow.
Yeah.
Wow, it's crazy.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm so glad modern medicine is where it is.
I know. We've benefited a lot from it. There's still ways to go about acceptance and things.
Right.
But yeah.
Right. Yeah. And of course.
Yeah.
But then there's the final classification, and that would be fairies as ethereal spirits. And this is what kind of came about in the Victorian era. And it changed fairies. Like, throughout time, fairies have actually gotten smaller as well. Like, smaller and smaller and smaller until you get to this Victorian era where they're smaller with little angelic wings and magical abilities and things like that. So, and one of the things was, in the Victorian era, there was lots of children's books made that were written to not upset little children. Like, even the Grimm's fairy tales, like, they're like, seventh edition is way less bloodthirsty than the first edition, if that's a good way of telling it. But yeah. So all these books, like, they just kind of stopped telling the stories of the trickster fairies, and they made them kind of benign and small and winged. So that's where we come into fairies now, I would say.
That's so interesting. Yeah, for sure. Mm-hmm.
Huh. Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, I thought that was Sarah. Sweet. You're welcome.
Yeah.
I liked learning about that. And it's fun to see, like, where that came from, and then all the stuff that we know now, where fairies are, like, in the Peter Pan, Tinkerbell, Fantasia, all that. And, like, oh, you can see little elements of things sprinkled in.
Yeah. Literally and figuratively.
Exactly.
Nice. Right on. So the thing that I was sort of curious about, and I'm grateful for your deep dive, because as per usual, I did a shallow dive. But I was curious about fairies or other fairy type creatures in folklore from countries around the world, not Europe.
Yeah. I think that's great, because that was harder to find too. So good job.
Yeah. It is. And so, well, I mean, I admittedly didn't spend a ton of time. So I did a very cursory sort of, but I would like to learn more. And I think I will probably do a little more research after we're done recording and put it in the show notes.
Ooh, okay. Cool.
But so check the show notes, folks. So let's start. So first of all, fairies, the idea of the word fairies, fairy and fae, which it comes from, I guess, and the fair folk, is European. Mm-hmm. So not all the countries around the world that have this type of folklore use that type of word. But so we're talking about spirits, supernatural beings, metaphysical beings, like you said. So I started off with Asia. So what I found really interesting, and I focused most on this, was that many Asian countries have fox fairies.
What?
Yeah, so as soon as I saw that, I was like, okay, well, Sarah is the fox lady, so we're going to talk about fox fairies. Yeah, so in China, and, well, let's see. So in China, there is the Huli Jing, and they are shapeshifters, so a little bit changeling. Like, they're not stealing your kid and replacing it, but so they're shapeshifters who are foxes.
Watch how you say that.
Shapeshifters who take human form so that they can interact with the human world better.
You know what that sounds like? It sounds like the wolves. What are those?
Yes, wolf walkers.
Yeah, wolf walkers.
Oh, werewolves. Yes. Wolf walkers and werewolves. Yeah. Wow. Yeah. So these are foxes, and the nine-tailed fox is the most famous of these. Mm. So the Huli Jing, they're shapeshifters who they can be either benevolent or malevolent, and nine-tailed fox is the most famous.
Is a nine-tailed fox happy or sad, benevolent or malevolent?
Well, so nine-tailed foxes, they appear in folklore and literature and the mythology, and depending on what the tale is that's being told, T-A-L-E,
right?
They can either be good or bad.
Okay, got it. Okay. Yeah.
So there's that. So then, in Japan, the fox fairies are called kitsune.
Oh.
And they also can morph into human form. They possess paranormal abilities that get more, they increase as they get older and wiser.
Wow.
Which is kind of cool. Yeah. So when I first saw this kitsune, I was like, wait, that's the kind of udon we order at Japanese restaurants. Kitsune or udon. Udon.
Okay.
I'm saying it wrong. Udon. So udon is like thick wheat noodles in soup. And kitsune, it means fox. It's a Japanese word for fox. But kitsune udon is named that because of a particular kitsune fairy, I guess, that liked the noodles or something.
That's so funny.
Yeah, isn't that cute?
Wow.
Okay. So that's some Asian or one type of Asian supernatural being or spirit. Wow. Then in the Americas, so we're going to go to Mexico first.
Oh, nice.
An old, old, old Mayan nature spirit called the Alux, A-L-U-X. It's a nature spirit, and it seems like its main purpose is to scare humans.
Nice.
That is the Mayan version. But then there's also in South and Southeastern Mexico, there's a similar kind of elf spirit kind of creature called chaneques. So they are like small elf pixie-like creatures. It means those who dwell in dangerous places. Mm. And they sort of lived in like craggy mountains and woods and caves and things.
Okay.
Supposedly they have the appearance of a toddler, but with a wrinkled old face of an old person.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
That sounds scary. So yeah. No wings on these.
No wings.
Okay. Mm-mm. Wow.
And then Europe. So pretty much every European country has their own version of fairies and that sort of the idea of fairies as we think of them. So like in Greek mythology, there's nymphs and satyrs. Those are the sort of the fairy-like creatures there. There's something called an encantado in Portugal, and they come from like a paradise-like underwater place called Encante, which sounds lovely.
Yeah.
there's a whole bunch, there's actually a ton of different countries that have lots of them. But anyway, there's a lot there. And then in Hawaii, there's the Menehune, and they are mythological dwarf people that live deep in the forests and the hidden valleys of the islands, far away from humans.
Wow.
And they're supposedly super good craftspeople. Their favorite food is bananas and fish.
So they're like little Santa elves, if they're little craftspeople.
Kinda, yeah.
That's what it sounds like.
And nobody but children and humans connected to the children can see the Menehune.
Oh, nice. I like that.
Yeah.
That's kind of a fun, fun thing.
Yeah.
Wow.
And so then I tried to find something from any country in Africa, and I had a hard time, so I want to do more research about that. But the one thing I did find was in Senegal, which is in Western Africa. So creatures called Yumbos, and they're sort of the earliest references to those are from this Irish man in the 1800s who spoke with a young woman who supposedly lived in Senegal when she was young. Mm. And so she told the story about these Yumbos. But then it sort of was like, there's not a lot of other scholarship to go along with that to back it up.
Okay.
So it's hard to know if it's real or not. So I need to do more research on that. So I will do a little more research and put that in show notes. But that was my worldwide search for fairy folk.
I love it. Well, I find it super interesting that like all around the world, fairies are kind of like live in this myth kind of space. You know how myth is something that all cultures have, and generally all cultures have very similar structures to their myths or very similar characters that populate the myths. And fairies are like this. And I'm just so intrigued. It's like fairies are part of our, what is that called? Like the
collective unconscious?
Yeah. Yeah. There you go. Wow.
Yes.
Scholar Bryn showing up. But yeah, isn't that crazy to, I mean, that's crazy.
So yeah. So that's so interesting that so many cultures all around the world have this same collective unconscious that it comes from somewhere.
Yeah.
It's in us, I guess.
That's what's interesting to me. Like, where does this come from? Like, how, why, who? It's crazy. Okay.
Yeah.
If anybody knows anything or can point us to maybe something to read, let us know. Cause
yes, please.
We want to know. All right. So now we're into our final question. This will be short, but it is, what are we excited about regarding fairies and or Tinkerbell? So Bryn, what are you excited about?
I am excited about fairy doors in the real world.
Oh my gosh. Okay. So tell me about this, because I think I have something to add, but you tell me first.
Cool. So a long time ago, a coworker of mine, when my daughter was probably six or seven, said, "Do you know about fairy doors?" And I said, "No." And she said, "Well, it's a big thing where I live." She lived in Seal Beach at the time, California. She said, "It's a thing where I live where you get a little dollhouse doll. You get a little dollhouse door. You paint it and you put it on a wall somewhere in your home.
Oh.
And that doorway allows you, or allows a fairy, if they want to come into your home, and you can leave them treats, you can leave them notes, you can, and if you're lucky, they'll write back to you or they'll leave you things." And I was very intrigued by this, so we did it, and a fairy moved in, and we had this notebook that was by the door on the floor, and we would write to her, and she would write back to us, and it was so much fun and so interesting. And so that was our first experience with fairy doors. Since then, I've noticed people just put fairy doors sometimes on trees outside. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you see them at businesses. But I just love this idea and this practice of opening yourself up to the fairies in a way that might allow them to come to you. And I think more people should do it. And I just love it.
I think that's so cool. Like, I didn't know that people would do them inside their homes, because all I've seen was actually what you said, like on trees. In fact, one day Richard and I were walking, and this was last summer during the pandemic, and we were walking in our neighborhood. There's this really cool three streets that are very like tons of trees overlooking the streets, and we always weave through them. And one day we saw a man cutting a hole in the bottom of a tree, and like not a hole, but like just a door like shape, right?
Okay.
Or yes. A heart or something. He was cutting something. And then the next day we walked by and he had cut a heart shape out of like one of the top of the tree, but then put it and made it like a door at the bottom of the tree.
Oh.
And it was like, you know, they had carved some letter or something in it. It was clearly made to be like a fairy door in this tree along our daily walk that we walked through. So
I thought
that was neat. And he was doing it with his daughter. You know, they were doing that together the day we saw them. And so I was like, oh, how cool is that? And since then, I think we've seen some other, you know, fairy doors outside, like near trees or little posts or something like that. So
yeah.
I think it's cool, but I never knew about the element of writing to the fairy.
Yeah. And I don't know how well known that one is. My friend had done that with her daughter.
Aww.
And so, and I think in Seal Beach, I don't know if it still is like this, but in Seal Beach, there a lot of businesses put up fairy doors.
Wow.
All over the place. So it was, you could do a fairy door tour, and then there's all sorts of businesses around fairy doors themselves. And there's tons of stuff on Etsy. You can buy fairy doors and you can get stuff to make fairy doors. Anyway.
Oh my gosh.
We would decorate the door for different holidays, and we eventually got little like dollhouse bench and table and little accessories to put out so that she could have some place to hang out if she wanted to, and it was really fun. There's a fairy door in our neighborhood on a tree also that's really cute.
Oh, do you still have your fairy door?
We have the fairy door. It is not up.
Okay, yes, because you've moved couple times, right?
We have. So we've moved twice since the fairy door was first put up, and we did put it up in this house, but it didn't last for very long.
Okay.
But I have it still, and I might repaint it and put it in my little home office now that I have, because it's just, I mean, who knows? There could be a fairy somewhere and
needs a home.
And she, wants to come and hang out a little bit.
Awesome. I love it. You know, that kind of reminds me of Monsters, Inc. too. How you go through the different doors.
Yes. That's a really good point. That's fun.
Yeah. Amazing. Oh my gosh. Now I want to try fairy doors. That's so cool.
Yeah. Why not? And it's like a little decorating thing you can do too. Cause we just got, it's just like a plain wood door and we painted it however we wanted.
Oh, that's cool.
And then I got like a little key a key charm, and we made a little key ring for it, because you have to leave a way for the fairy to get in and out, okay. right? So you need to, she's going to need a key. So you leave the key, and then they usually show up and they have some sort of vehicle to travel. Our fairy had a skateboard, which was really cool.
How cute. That's amazing.
Yeah. So fairy doors. That's my excitement.
Awesome.
What's yours, Sarah? What are you excited about?
I am excited about possible meeting with Tinkerbell at Disneyland.
Yay.
Because, like I said, the you can't visit with her right now in her Tinkerbell's nook.
In Pixie Hollow.
Pixie Hollow, exactly. But back in April of 2021, there was news that they were testing a virtual meet and greet with Tinkerbell at Disneyland. So basically, Imagineers would pull families like, oh, here, come over here to this little room, and we're going to test this virtual meet and greet with you. So a couple families got to do this, and it was picked up by laughingplace.com.
Oh,
And one lucky guest posted on her Instagram account about her experience with this playtest. And what they are, it looks like the kids or the family is drawn into this room that is set up with a little fairy book and a little magic mirror almost.
Oh,
right? Uh-huh. And then you basically talk to your fairy through the magic mirror. So you're not actually in the same room with her, but she's small, and then, but in the mirror, it's big. You know, she's big, like normal size.
Yeah.
And then you get to just like chat with her and have a little fairy chatting experience.
Yeah, like you would have normally in Pixie Hollow, but just through technology.
Exactly. And this is from Jen.Tanaka on Instagram. She writes, during A Touch of Disney, our family was asked to participate in an Imagineering playtest where the kids learned all about Pixie Hollow with their fairy, with Tinkerbell. The children were starstruck at first, but then the magic took over and they were chatting with Tinkerbell as if she were a dear friend. It was truly a special visit.
Oh, that's lovely.
Yeah, isn't it? I thought that was really neat. So, gosh, I need to have a kid so I can be pulled aside and tested on this.
I wonder how soon they'll implement it for real.
Right. Well, they're testing it, so that doesn't mean it'll necessarily be implemented, but it seems like it would. I mean, if they already have the room built and things like that.
Yeah. And people would certainly want to do it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
So I thought that was neat.
That's lovely. Aw, yay.
So I'll be first in line if they introduce this in the parks. Like, yay, I want to meet Tinkerbell.
Yay.
All right. Well, super fun chatting with you about Tinkerbell and fairies.
Yes. I'm so glad we did this topic.
It's a really cool topic. I'm so glad too. We had a lot to say about it. You were right.
See? Yes. It's a many faceted thing.
Yes. So now we have to move on to our section, Totally Talk to Us, where you guys have commented on social media or maybe left us a review. So I have a couple comments I want to bring up. And one is from Courtney Turkel, who wrote about our episode on tea on Instagram. And she said, the best thing that we ever did was have afternoon tea at the Disneyland Hotel. It was so cute. We got to pick our tea and whether or not we wanted a salad with the other sweets and sandwiches that came with it, as well as a glass of wine. See, they have tea and wine.
Yeah.
And she goes on, the first time it was Mickey 90 themed for his 90th birthday, and the second time it was Alice in Wonderland themed.
Sweet.
How fun. And I have been there once to have tea as well.
Oh, cool. I have not.
Okay.
But I love the idea of a themed tea.
Yes.
That's fun.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember if ours was themed. I think it was like before they started theming them. Yeah, I like got in the first round of that.
Got it.
All right, and then we have a new review on Apple Podcasts.
Hey, ding, ding, woo! Ding. That's so awesome.
It is from 3D King US, and I know who that is. It's my dad. Thanks, Peter.
Oh, yay. Thank you, Peter.
But he writes, upbeat, fun, and always informative. I wait every month just to listen to Totally Tell Me Everything podcast. Sarah and Bryn always deliver something interesting to talk about. But they don't just talk, as both of them delve into some history, customs, or unusual facts about the subject discussed. For instance, did you know lipstick was frowned upon at one time, and then at another period in history, encouraged? And who really created the first printing press? And where high tea began is something very few of us would recognize. Great job, ladies.
Aw, thanks, Peter. You're the best.
Yes, thank you, Dad. Aw, I love that. So great, great interview. What is it called? Review.
It's a review.
It's a review. Great, great review. Thank you. If anyone else wants to write a review on their favorite podcatcher, that would be amazing. We love that.
You don't have to be one of our parents. You can you can just write it even if you don't know us.
Or our husbands. You don't have to be those either.
Yeah. We'll take them from anybody, really.
It's true. But we do have a question for everyone. And after listening to this episode, we want to know, what version of Tinkerbell or fairies in general is your favorite? Let us know. Either send us an email to share at Skywalking Through Neverland, or we are on Instagram at Totally Tell Me Everything.
It's totally delightful to hear from you, truly.
Yes, we love it. Oh, I love that. Well, that brings us to the end of our talk.
Oh.
I know. So we want to thank you all for listening. You can connect with us, like I said, on Instagram at Totally Tell Me Everything, or I am at Jedi Tink, and Bryn.
I'm at Brynane, B-R-Y-N-A-N-E.
There you go. And you can also find us both in the Skywalking Through Neverland Facebook group. So you can search Facebook for Skywalking Through Neverland group and request to join and then answer the questions that pop up. And then, of course, you can email us and let us know what version of Tinkerbell or fairies is your favorite. And you can email us share@skywalkingthroughneverland.com.
We are part of the Skywalking Network.
Skynet.
Where you can also find other great shows like Skywalking Through Neverland.
The Neverland Clubhouse. I sense a theme here.
Max Effects Podcast.
Resilience Squadron.
Sabers and Spells.
New podcast, Star Warsologies, about science and Star Wars.
And the classic Marvel Star Wars comics.
That's right. And then sign up for our Skywalking Network newsletter. You can go to skywalkingthroughneverland.com and click on the link, sign up for our newsletter, or that link will be in the show notes as well. So, come sit by us next month, and we'll totally tell you everything about what, Bryn?
Another fun topic. topic.
I love how you say that. Subject, topic. There's not a good word for that, you know? There's not a word that rolls off the tongue.
Maybe we'll have to brainstorm some other words other than topic.
It's a topic. I love it. Yay. All right. And then I'll play the little bell sound.
Yes.